right, I call this meeting to order.
Okay, we're ready.
I'm sorry to say that Rich is out sick and Carolyn is in like Colorado doing a climate reality project training, which is great. So we're down a few. I don't know where Jay is, but hopefully he'll show up. All right, has everyone gotten a chance to look at the minutes from February 1st? These are not the most recent minutes, so throw your mind back a month. This is not last meeting's minutes. And Terry has, this is like, there was a couple snowstorms in between this and today, so Terry, we're giving you a pass.
Was I even at this one?
Yes, you were. Plus, we've had a lot of administrative.
Oh, I don't think I was here.
You weren't, Jen.
No, I was sitting, right. Because I was like, oh, he showed it on the screen. I didn't.
Now I understand why you weren't. That wasn't
in my worldview.
You're right.
Motion approved.
You have a second?
I second.
Need more time, Molly?
No, it's okay. Yeah.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain?
I have to abstain.
Okay, there we go. All right, no public to make a comment, so I'll move on to the chair report. All right, 2 points. One is that regretfully, because Rich was sick today, we had to postpone our visit with the mayor.
Oh, darn.
Yeah, I know. And I had done my homework and prepared a nice little summary of both what I felt the report highlighted, what our reactions were to it, and what I wanted the mayor to think about going forward and, you know, seek his feedback. So at least I had all that done, and I feel ready to go into a meeting with him. I also did some, in preparation for it, I just reviewed a lot of the city plans and documents that could pertain to trees. Not ordinances and so forth, but things like the recent pedestrian bicycle plan, comprehensive plan, there was a climate mitigation not plan but report that involved a lot of public feedback, and a lot of the public who went made comments about trees, and so that got integrated into the report in a pretty significant way. And this is, of course, is the Sustainable Northampton plan, which actually is pretty weak on recommendations about trees, and that's largely because there was a weak commission and there was no tree warden at the time when that plan was created and then revised. So if that plan, when that plan comes up for revision again, we're gonna, you know, be really, really involved in that. Anyway, all of those things that I reviewed just to think about how we demonstrate that the city is already behind, you know, a comprehensive tree plan, and it's a matter now of just executing it, because it's, you know, well documented, a lot of these different, broadly accepted plans. And I do plan on, you know, from my own perspective, I know there's a lot of you on this commission, I think all of us actually, feel very strongly that climate change is a looming threat, and that this is one of our best ways to increase our resilience and prepare for it, in addition to decreasing our energy use and sequestering carbon. Yeah. So I'm going to be strongly pitching this from that perspective.
Yeah.
And because David does see himself as a billionaire, I'm hoping that it won't be a hard sell. I think that the main thing is going to be sticker shock. So I also put together a grid of potential leverageable funds and leverageable resources that we could consider if we have to make some hard choices. I think it's going to be very easy, certainly relative to the other things that the plan calls for, to fundraise for tree planting. And so, what that looks like is remains to be seen. But there's lots of different models. And maybe Rob, during your time, if you have a little moment, you can give us this update on the 501c3 status of Northampton. Okay.
When you said leverage funds, what did that
mean? It means funds that you can draw from outward that will help amplify the pot of money the city would put forward for this. So, and it would also demonstrate to the city, and in reverse, demonstrate to potential funders that both parties are serious, like that there's investments from both sides. So for example, when you apply for a CPA grant, which we could potentially do for certain aspects, remember Sarah LaValle from the CPC came and spoke to us, and they want to see that you've leveraged other sources of funds, so not just from the city, but also, for example, if there's DCR money, which we know there is, if there's any crowdsourcing opportunities, so stuff like that. All right, so that's, so to, hopefully we'll meet the mayor next week. We're batting back and forth some dates. Columbia Gas, okay. I don't know if you guys heard, read in the paper, whatever, but Columbia Gas has made a very strong and public commitment to repairing and replacing all of the gas leaks in its service area. Yay, yes.
Really great,
yeah. Yeah, and this really all started because of a neighborhood that became aware of gas leaks on their block, made a big public stink about it, wrote directly to the CEO of Columbia Gas, and it just turns out that he was an open-minded man, and was, and you know, was a parent and a grandparent, and was willing to zoom out and go, wow, this is not immediately costly to us, because it's not. All leaks are just passed on in a flat rate to every ratepayer in the state, so there's no financial incentive there. And their mission has always been protect public safety and property. So if there's a leak that it threatens either of those things, they address them. But if there are leaks that do none of that, like that do not imminently threaten the public, they just let them gush. So they're determining of these so-called grade 3 leaks, which are the ones that pose the least imminent threat, which are the highest gushers. And of those, they're gonna try to repair all of the biggest gushers in 2017. And if they do that, they will, because the biggest gushers gush so much, it will effectively cut the gas leaks by 50%, the amount of methane being leaked out by 50%.
50?
Yeah.
Do you have an idea of, like, just roughly how many leaks?
Well, you know, their service area runs all the way from Springfield up through Northampton. I'm not sure it goes much further north.
Well, I guess I just meant how many around here.
There were 100 identified in Northampton, and there were 500 identified in Springfield. And then, of course, there were something in the range of like 3,500 leaks.
100 total leaks in Northampton?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And those were grade 3. It was a pleasure working with this guy. And the other thing is, I showed up yesterday at the council has a public utilities and public works meeting. They have a commission that, because you know the whole board of public works has been sort of restructured, and so now there is a subcommittee of the city council. Jim Nash, Bill Dwight, Dennis Bidwell, and David Murphy, at least those are the people who were there, that helped to oversee public works and utilities. And Steve Bryant from Columbia Gas gave a presentation. Marty Nathan, who represents that neighborhood, was also there. And I was given the opportunity, hello Jay. I was given the opportunity to say a few words too, and I just expressed the interest in having a spreadsheet that we could overlay on Treekeeper of all of the leaks. Until they're all repaired or replaced, I just see that as valuable information when we're putting trees down.
There are two sites where we're not putting trees down because we think there are leaks, but we don't know if there are or not.
Yeah. Okay.
So,
well,
one of them is an important site. So.
Okay.
So it would be great. I mean, then
yeah.
I would immediately.
So, do you guys agree that that's valuable information? So, I am hooking up by email Rich and Steve,
When you say spreadsheet, you mean just like an Excel type thing or on a map where you can see?
Well, anything on a spreadsheet can be put in a tree keeper and overlaid.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
That would be useful.
Yeah. As long as you have addresses associated with everyone.
That's interesting. Is that information open to the public too?
Well, you can find that information. It might not be the latest information, but you can find that information at the website Heat MA. So it's HEETMA.
You mean specific sites?
You can see, a few years ago, the governor, the regulations changed to require all utilities to disclose locations of their leaks.
Oh.
And so this woman out in Cambridge, Audrey Schulman, took it upon herself to download all that into a Google map and then put it out for the public at large to see. And this is what's come out of it, because it was that neighborhood group from Massasoit Street that got a hold of that and started making a fuss. And they actually worked with citizens from Springfield, the Springfield Climate Justice Coalition. Mm. And so they jointly drafted a letter to CEQA, Brian. Mm. So anyway, wow. That's just a bit of good news.
Yeah, yeah, it's cool.
Yeah.
Nice for a change.
I know. It is. I feel like I need to ask Steve, like, will you offer leadership training to other utility CEOs? Because your way is so...
It could make such a huge difference if other states did this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, and not only other states, and not every utility in the state of Massachusetts is agreed.
Oh.
This is just Columbia Gas Service Area, which is very discreet.
Yeah, it would be great to
spread it. But he does say that he is sharing a little bit, and I'll just follow up on it. He's a great guy.
Right.
Kind of waiting for the shoe to drop, you know?
Yeah, right. It's a catch.
Him to pull the skeleton out of the closet. Yeah. But
a rate increase.
Yeah, well, there will be short-term rate increase. Absolutely. I mean, they have to replace thousands of miles of 100-year-old plus cast iron pipes. And apparently it's not the pipes themselves that are a problem, it's the joints, you know, holding the pipes together where they're leaking. So that's my chair report. I don't think there's anything else. Molly is going to be joining Rich, thanks to the city, right?
Yeah.
You want to just say?
It's a conference on, I guess, Tuesday the 7th at UMass about urban shade trees.
Yeah, it's very relevant. And yeah. Marilyn had put it out to everybody. I'm going to be away, but you expressed interest. And then I hooked you up with Rich, and Rich was able to pay for her.
Oh, nice.
For the cost for her.
Who's the other person? There's a third person going too.
Tony Zachowitz.
Right.
Oh, great.
Who's that?
He's the tree surgeon.
He's the chief arborist.
Yeah.
Oh, with the city? Tony. He's a city employee?
Yes.
Okay,
great.
You'll have to meet the crew.
Yeah.
He's the head of the crew.
Yeah, they're good guys.
Great. I look forward to it.
All right, I think that's it from as far as the chair report. We're going to have to skip over the chair warden report. All right, tree management plan next steps. Actually, I did give some thought to that because I was trying to summarize from our spreadsheet what some of us had identified as next steps to present to the mayor. So I can throw out a couple that I think that you guys have already stated, and then we can either use those as a conversation or you can pop in some more. Let's see if I can find that.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
Can you send me the link to the spreadsheet? Can I look at it?
Oh yeah, Terry, I meant to a while ago. Sorry about that.
That's great, thank you.
Okay, So one of the things I think that we agreed was that we would aggressively work to finalize the recommended tree list, and that's and the planting guidelines, and that's actually on today's agenda. Another thing is that we would begin identifying priority sites for planting, and I think that might be on the agenda today too. That we, based on the mayor's reactions in when we meet the Hamp, another thing will be to start exploring more aggressively funding resource leveraging opportunities. Not only funding, but also volunteer. And then one of the things that came up that you mentioned, Molly, which I thought was a really good point, is considering a rapid response plan for pest infestation. You know, it being only a matter of time before the Emerald Ash Borer hits us. So what's our plan?
Right. Is there anything we can even do?
So, you know, these are all just things that we've popcorned so far about what next steps are following the tree management plan. And of course, the big one is, how does the mayor feel about it, and how much is he going to get behind it? And that's... Jay, before you came in, I mentioned that we had to postpone our meeting with the mayor today because Rich is sick. So, it gives you more time to give me feedback, Jay. Are you strung out? Are you starting a new job?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. All right. How's it going?
It's going well. I like it. Working 10 to 12 hours a day.
Yeah. Hey. Yeah. Okay. Wow. I understand. Well, I mean, at the very least, Jay, if you could just, I think that we've covered a lot in that Google spreadsheet that we brainstormed. So if, you know, even going on there and seeing if there's anything you strongly disagree with would be helpful. But, you know, I'm only nudging you because you're a value member of the commission, and especially as the only arborist on the commission, I'd really love to have your input. All right, Terry, I am putting you, I'm sharing this.
Thank you.
All right, any other?
Is that
next steps?
The link to that page, is that in the minutes, one of the past minutes?
The link to the spreadsheet,
the comment page,
the actions?
Yeah.
Well, you know,
it wouldn't be in the minutes, but I'll just look for an email from you and find it again.
You can do that, or do you know how to go to your Google Drive?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, yeah, it's in there.
So you just go to your Google Drive and then you know do a word search.
Oh, okay. I forgot it was right. It's a Google page, right?
Yep. You know, I didn't know, Todd, I was in reviewing that Google spreadsheet about impressions and reactions. I noticed that you argued, and I love that you're often the only one in the room that's thinking this way, because you're a planner, about how the street guidelines regarding sidewalks, you know, make it really, really hard, really, really limit our options for planting trees. And I just didn't know if at this point in time that felt out of the scope of what I wanted to bring to the mayor. You know, just considering that this is a long-term process, and what we're, I think, first trying to do is just get him to get on board with some of the basic recommendations from Davey, and that kind of falls outside of it. So what are your feelings about that?
Yeah, I mean, that's probably correct, with, you know, first go around with the mayor, and the issue with the street guidelines is that it's a newish policy.
I know.
I think the goal would be to just, you know, okay, that was made before we existed and before the climate stuff really started ramping up. And maybe we just need to hit pause on that and go a little bit back to the drawing board and see if there's a bit more of a compromise that can be made.
Yeah. Molly, are you following this?
No, I'm not sure what the issue is.
Give some background.
Yeah.
So the city in general adopted a policy a little while ago after the pedestrian and bike kind of movement that...
Is it a complete street? Is it part of complete streets?
That's different.
Okay.
That's different.
All right.
But they have adopted the Mass DOT Complete Streets, which is basically just highway buildings. But the policy generally is for street renovation and street projects, new streets and kind of redoing streets. The assumption is that there should be sidewalks on both sides of the street. And it's up to the neighbors or the residents or someone to say, no, there should only be sidewalk on one, or there should be no sidewalk at all. And that kind of presumption that that all streets are suitable for and should have sidewalks on both sides of the street, given the narrow width of many of our right-of-ways that, you know, that they're old, precludes suitable tree planting belts. And you see it in some of the recent construction that we have had, where there's sidewalks to nowhere and sidewalks, you know, with no one living on them or what have you. And, you know, my general thought is, you know, we really need to step back and look at a bit more of a holistic strategy where, you know, maybe let's think this through, put the sidewalk under the poles and that narrow greenway can have cherry trees, and on the other side, we can plant the heck out of it.
Was this a city, this came from the city, or was this a statewide?
No, it's the city. It's the city kind of just assumption based on probably the public input, you know, several years ago, saying we really need to do more with bike and ped.
Yeah.
Fine, but, you know, we didn't exist back then. The decision necessarily did not include all the elements that make a bike and ped friendly street, one of which obviously is street.
Yeah, just to give you an example, you know how much of an advocate of biking and walking James Lowenthal is.
Yeah.
So he sat on the bike ped subcommittee for years and pushed a lot of this, and when I had a phone call with him, oh, I don't know, 4 months ago or something about it, and the way it hems street trees, he said, you know, you're so right, and I'm chagrined to admit it was not on our radar.
Didn't think about it, yeah.
Yeah.
So I had an informal discussion with someone over at DPW about Hinkley Street. I keep going back to Hinkley Street, because that's where people actually want trees, on the side of the street where there is no sidewalk.
Yeah. Hinkley's in Bay State Village?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so sidewalk one side, no sidewalk on the other. They're asking for trees on the side of the sidewalk. I don't know what to do. And so I did speak to someone at DPW, and they said that there won't be a second sidewalk at Hinkley because it's got to do with the width. So we could actually, at this point, if we find out what width that is, that's the minimum, find out how many streets actually are likely to get even accommodate a second sidewalk. Mm-hmm. In other words, it seems like many, many, many streets aren't wide enough for a second sidewalk. So Hinkley Street will get planted on one.
Okay.
So it'd be great if somebody, like, I don't think I'm the person to approach, because you got to go into, and you could just get a number. I mean, just what's the width? And then
I don't think it's that easy to come up with that number.
So Todd,
It depends on the traffic of the street. You know, how wide you're going to make the pavement.
Whether you have a bicycle lane. Yeah. I mean, there's a whole bunch of things.
Yeah.
You were for a while attending the bike ped subcommittee meetings, and were you ever actually, sworn in as a member? You were.
Yep.
Okay, great. So that's still something you're doing?
Yes, 7 a.m.
And it's once a month?
Yeah,
generally.
So once a month, can I give you a spot on the agenda to give a report on, you know, what's happening with that, whether or not there's anything new coming up?
If something pops us. I mean, sometimes they're more about funding and voice or ability to talk about that kind of stuff. I'm not convinced that's where the magic's going to happen.
Yeah, it's kind of a toothless commission, right?
It is advisory to advisory. Yeah.
Are you anticipating that there would be controversy about bringing the tree issue in, and that some people are going to want to stick to the two sidewalk view, even when we say, what about the trees? Or is it just that people forgot to think about trees, is there going to be pushback on that?
I don't know if I'd use the word controversy, but anytime you go and change standards that have to do with infrastructure, usually under the realm of DPW, you're going to run into a process at the very least.
Sure, a process.
Yeah.
I'm just wondering, like, in that process, do you anticipate there'd be pushback on the idea itself, or just pushback because it's like, oh, God, we have to change it?
Possibly both, yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
I mean, the policy right now, okay, it's easy. And the policy I'm advocating for is more complicated, nuanced.
Yeah, right.
All right. Tying back into the plan, any other things you feel, you folks feel are next steps that bubble up out of it?
Well, I mean, I just keep thinking about getting all that work done. Well, once it gets approved, yes. I guess once we get, maybe I'm jumping ahead too far.
Approved?
Well, I mean, funded, I guess.
Well, funded, yeah. I was trying to bring up at the last meeting, when I was here. You were not here when I was trying to bring it up.
Oh, yeah.
That in some ways, just how much work needs to be done by the DPW, we won't really know until Rich goes out and tests the accuracy or his level of agreement with the assessments that were made by the survey. So, you know, they're saying take down 900 trees. He might say, well, that they'll be taken down, but maybe that's a 10 or 15 year stretch out that far. And that would greatly change the level of work.
Yeah, so that's one of the things we've got on the, mentioning to the mayor that is a high priority for Rich to reassess all of those recommended tree removals. And so until that's done, that's gonna largely influence what a timeline might look like.
Yeah, and so the timeline might not, I mean, in terms of funding, it may not be that wildly different than what's currently being
I'm hoping it'll be more aggressive.
Yes, yes, more aggressive, but the problem is that I can see that, as you mentioned, the leap to where they are, this seems like a leap we can't make.
You mean to what they recommend?
Yeah. And so I'm just saying, it might be that we're here, they're saying we should be here, maybe if we just step it up a little, given a reassessment by Rich of the needs, maybe, because, you know, right now, Rich has kind of got it geared up to plant about 200 trees, 250 maybe.
To
plant 250 trees a year, and to keep, you know, and they have some years removed up to 80, I think, some years. So, you know, it's not so certain. So I guess I'm just saying, getting into the detail of what to do and how, where we stand, doesn't seem like that good enough. Until we have a little bit better feedback.
Right. Yeah, well, I also think that we're going to have to really strictly monitor our mortality rate, especially in the light of more severe heat and drought. Mm-hmm. I'm very concerned about that. I feel like we have no viable plan for watering these trees, and so I feel like that's something that we're going to need to very seriously address, or we're going to be throwing money down the drain.
So being out there last summer, the mortality rate seemed hard to control were the trees that were too big to water.
Oh.
Those were the trees that really seemed...
You mean established trees?
Well, trees that are like 6, 8 inches.
That have been there for a number of years.
The trees that are 5, 10 years old. Because the little trees, you can't organize themselves to water. They just need 10 or 20 gallons dumped on them once a week. But once they get, you know, bigger,
and spread out,
they're spread out, and they consume so much water that it's not really practical for water.
Yeah.
So there were some trees.
There's not much we can do about those.
Well, that's where the mortality rate and the future weather change and needing probably different species of tree.
Right.
I mean, there are some marginally hardy species.
Yeah.
Marginally hardy species. You know, like there's a lot of red maples planted in really marginal.
I'm really talking about red maples.
Soils, yeah.
And there were a lot.
Last summer was bad.
Right.
Yeah. And so it didn't matter.
So maybe more.
The little ones.
Oaks and hickories.
Were fine. The little ones were fine.
Yeah.
Well, we had some fair amount of mortality among our brand new ones, didn't we, Rob?
Not that I know about.
I mean, so the bare roots.
Bare roots, the bare root ones.
Yeah, but to me, they were like, those ones were destined to die, coming off the truck.
But yeah, there was some...
Issues.
Yeah.
So I wouldn't include the bare roots in our statistics because...
Yeah, that was like an experiment.
They arrived with bare, dry roots. We should have rejected them.
Yeah.
So I would say the mortality rate is probably very low. But, you know, we'll see in the spring. One of the things that Jay has pointed out is that they have a hard summer and then they'll go into the fall preference, so when they'll come out.
Right.
Has yet to be seen, but they went into the fall green and how they'll come out.
Well, Jay, I just want to ask, you know, since you have the most experience around the table in large-scale tree planting, what are the best models you've seen for doing the watering after really, you know, I mean, it's an economy of scale question.
I think it's something that I don't understand is you're planting a tree in someone's house, in front of their house, why we're not getting more
buy-in
from the city.
I don't think that this year, if it's anywhere near normal, unless we have a very severe drought.
We did.
I know, I'm saying last summer we had a really severe drought, so that's why the city got involved in watering trees. Mm-hmm. But normally, I mean, I've been planting trees for 4 years, and the city never watered any trees on lawns, and they all survived. So
did you, and you extracted an agreement from everybody?
Yeah, and they all watered the trees. Okay. I mean, what happened last summer was that, well, first of all, in previous years, we just left like a donut of earth around, you know, a little berm, told people to fill the berm. But then this year, it was just felt, I think, the ridge, and I concur that the people filling the berm, the trees were probably going to die because unless every tree got watered exactly each on a regular schedule, the water leaked out of the berm, the tree was dead. And so Rich put the gator bags on. And in some cases, the gator bags aren't even, except, you know, you have to have a hose that goes all the way out to the gator bag. Not everybody even had that. And not only that, but we didn't show people how to fill a gator bag.
Yeah, when I was looking at those, I couldn't see, where does the water get in those? Yeah.
You know, we've solved that now. We have tags that...
Right.
Water here.
Yeah.
Right. So we could consider, yeah. I guess Rich has to decide, he's going to put gator bags back on all the trees on the lawn, setback trees. Then we have to make sure that people are ready to actually fill the bags. And it's up to Rich. But, you know, hopefully what happened last summer won't happen again. But maybe it will.
Well, I think we can, in general, with climate change, we can expect more of that to happen.
Yeah, and even
it's
more
predicted.
Severe.
That's what's predicted, yeah. More droughts.
Yeah.
More, less rain in the summer, more precipitation in the winter. Yeah.
And more severe heat. I mean,
yeah.
More.
Yeah, New England is supposed to heat up more faster than other parts of the country.
That's another thing about
high event rain.
Right.
Yeah.
That's another thing, is it wasn't just that it was a drought, it was also extremely hot.
It was extremely hot.
Yeah, so it doesn't always coincide.
I am curious to know if you have any other ideas, experience to bring to the table.
About how to water?
Yeah, and I realize I because I'm...
People
I'm,
to buy in, I think, is the key.
Yeah, I agree.
Well, that's one thing, people can buy in for the setbacks, but I think the chance of getting people to water the trees in the tree belt is pretty low.
In front of their house?
I have an idea.
It's low.
Based on your personal experience?
Yeah. Because we're planting trees without, it's not their tree, some of them don't want the tree. Mm-hmm. Quite a few of them don't want the tree.
But just so you know, that is not the experience of at least Worcester, at least the folks that I spoke to, Worcester Tree Initiative. They got abutters to plant and their tags. To water, and their outreach on getting the watering was, I mean, they described it as effective. I don't, you know, I wasn't there to test the results.
I have an idea. You know how on the bike path, there's people who have adopted certain sections and their name is right there. This section is maintained by Esther Ralston and, you know, or Stan the Fix-It Man. What if we tried to do like an adopt a tree? You know, adopt this tree. This is, you know, it says the person's name on it. this tree is adopted by so-and-so.
Yeah.
And we could even like name the tree or something. You know, that person can name the tree or, you know, adopt it. And then their name is on it, and then they might have more commitment to keep watering it.
So the Ridge sends a truck out on a circuit.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, skipping a tree on the circuit, it's, you know, and
if we get people to buy in, then he doesn't have to go on the circuit. That's the whole point.
Yeah.
I happen to think that if you think about the logistics of adopting a tree that's not immediately next to your house.
Yeah.
How are you getting
I'm thinking
the water
it would be one near your house.
Okay.
It would have to be one near your house. Yeah.
Right. That is, if you could do it by bucket, it would be a little bit more likely.
I think we need to get in front of it this year a little bit better. I think that maybe, you know, it's going to be a letter to the editor from, you know, on our behalf saying that we're really, you know, we're continuing our aggressive tree planting and we're looking for people and, you know, and contextualize it in last year was a drought year. We can expect more, the same or worse, and we really need everybody. And then we could also potentially, Rich has mentioned this numbers of times, put it in a little flyer in the water and sewer bill.
Mm.
You know, and that's something that every property owner opens up.
Then what do you do when the city has a water ban?
Unless it's a really severe water ban, it doesn't preclude you from watering after 5 p.m.
Time
that you
water?
Yeah.
And hand water. You got hand water.
Yeah, you got hand water.
Oh, you can use a
hose at the first stage. I mean, when it gets really restricted, then you're limited to like filling up a water can, and then when it's really restricted, nothing
else.
Oh, I don't remember getting notices about levels of restriction.
Because the first level.
Oh, really? Yeah. Oh, there's more severe after that.
Yeah. We were this close to getting to the second level.
Right.
We never did.
And then you're not allowed to water at all outside, and so Rich is thinking of developing a non-potable water source.
Mm.
All right, I am willing to draft a letter to the editor and potentially some information that goes into an insert regarding watering.
I think it's a bad idea. I think you need to talk to Rich about it because. For him to have a tree here and a tree there, just keeping track of who's watering what tree, he may prefer to just send the truck around.
Well, here's the
thing.
What's the harm of both?
To attack a neighborhood. You know what I mean? Not attack, but I get what you're saying. That if he's got 20 trees on a street and a couple of them are, let's say, four being watered.
Yeah. Okay, so I don't think we're disagreeing. What I'm saying, and by the way, I'm sorry, this is so not like me to get this far off topic, but we're sort of basking in the luxury of the absence of Rich's tree ward report. And then I'm going to want to wrap this up. But I think that you can do both. In fact, you know, I think we all agree that trees should be watered more than once a week. And the brand new trees in a drought condition, I mean, I had to water my baby trees 3 times a week, and they were still struggling. The tree crew can still continue, although I think they're going to be majorly taxed if we're adding another 250 trees. And then if the residents water too, then that is just bonus. That's
yes, I agree as a bonus, but as a way of. Mm. Causing Rich not to have to send the truck out there. I just don't see that.
I think we're going to get to a point of unsustainability.
I don't disagree.
So we've got to figure something out.
All right.
Well,
all right. And then I'm going to take one more comment and then
Rich is working on this problem. I mean, you should speak to him. He is working on the
okay, I haven't heard any updates on it. So.
He has updates.
There is, I forget which eastern city did this, but they hired. Interns for the summer to go out on bicycles and water trees.
Where did they get the water from?
They have a cart they carry on the bicycle. I don't know.
Wow.
They have a way of getting water.
Okay.
But they water a lot of trees that way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's Cambridge or Newton.
Yeah, it's Cambridge. All right.
I think that's possible.
Okay, I'm going to wrap this one up and we're going to move on to the next topic. Does anyone want to say anything else about the tree management plan?
No.
Okay.
I would really push on the trees as infrastructure.
Yeah. You mean in speaking to the mayor?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I have one last comment about it. It's not a comment, question, really. Just, we decided not to adopt this as it is without some kind of cover letter or changes as our plan. Do we have a process for, I'm sure we do, I just forgot.
Yeah, I'm making that clear, that there are aspects of the plan that we are agreed with. I think we generally agree that the plan is sound, that it is, that the data behind it is solid. And we agree with some of the recommendations, but I'm going to obviously express the ones that we don't necessarily agree with. I think one of my questions to the mayor is, you know, we're happy to put forward a proposal. We need some input from you as to what that's going to look like, so we're not wasting our time. So I think that if, you know, we'll know a lot more.
So you want feedback from him and then?
And then we go from there.
All right.
All right? Okay. Next on the agenda, planting priorities. This doesn't even need 10 minutes probably, although I wouldn't mind.
What about the recommended trees?
Oh, sorry. Okay. Yeah. Go ahead. Jay and Jen, you're up.
Okay, this is where the tree list is right now. I have two things I want a little bit of feedback on. So Jay and I met several times. We went through the old Northampton tree list. We went through these two documents, the Cornell recommends and then the Vermont one,
mm-hmm.
and came up with we do have a list. We ran it by the committee one time, and folks wanted to have it organized in a little bit different way, by size in particular. So we met again and sized all the trees. So the question I have, one of the questions, so that's kind of where it's at. So the question I have is originally we had a cover sheet that said, okay, here's the list and here's two links you have to go to get more information about the trees. Because it's a lot to make some kind of handout that has like, okay, sweet gum, you know, you need this kind of soil and it's good for dry or wet or whatever. So there's a couple options here. One was somebody said, well, we could have like screenshots of, okay, we picked this, here's an example. We picked this tree, here's an example of the pages that would come up if you looked at it, and that would be contained in there. So that's method A. The other method is we could just reproduce the pages that are like this from this Vermont guide. I found out that if you do not use the entire thing, you don't have to get it's not a copyright violation, you just cite the pages, and it could be attached to that. So I guess that's one of my main questions. Do we want to move forward by having this whole bunch of, I can pass it around?
Yeah.
This whole bunch of pages? It's got different, like, smiley face for, it's, you know, it's pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
What do you have to leave out in order not to?
It's a public document. It can't be copyrighted. That's a state document.
Kinda. Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
So it's not an issue if we just lift the pages, and it would be good to just say this is where we got them from. I asked the librarians at my school. They know that kind of stuff.
The tree selector pages.
Yes, correct. Okay. Yeah, not the whole document.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
So the question is, pursue that end or pursue just the cover sheet with an example saying, you choose a tree, you say, I want a big tree, okay? You choose one, but then go over here and this is what you have to find out. Like,
right tree.
You talking about hyperlinks then? Did you talk, are you talking about that, or would there be an actual hard copy?
Well, there could be a hard copy. We could have it hard copied for somebody that walks in and wants a hard copy, because it could be a homeowner, it could be anybody. And we could also have it, you know, digitally on the internet, that somewhere that they could just click on.
Yeah.
Wouldn't this be way more easier just to use the pages out of that?
Somewhat. There are some trees in there that we would not recommend. Okay. Ash, for example, yeah. You know, that
and,
kind of thing.
And there may be trees missing because they're farther north.
I don't know.
You want to check and see?
This is the one that you like.
Yeah, I like
that one. Yeah, pretty user friendly. Yeah.
This purpose is to go, is for us to use to figure out trees or to, for what? For
so what the what we want, what we had in the past and what we want is a document. Northampton Public Shade Tree Commission recommended trees for planting in Northampton. So somebody could go on the website and get it.
Oh, I see.
Or it would be in physical hard copy when they go to the planning board. A developer is handed when they submit a plan.
Okay, so anybody plant trees on their own, like off the city property?
Yeah, they could use it, but also the planning board had a list that was about 8 species long of. Here are some trees you can plant in Northampton.
I see.
And ash was on it. You know, some trees that we definitely don't want anymore.
Ash
still is on it.
So that's, I guess, my question. Before I like put all more work into this, like organizing it, I just kind of wanted to know, like, what way do we want to go? Do we want to go with the physical pages attached, like, you know, these pages attached, or an exam here? Go here and look at the pages yourself. Here's an example.
I'd recommend for the next step that we do have our list, mm-hmm. and that may not include X, Y, and Z species, mm-hmm. or it may add whatever species that we have, and we copy the pages of that document, blacking out any species is not on our
list.
That's
what I would do.
And ask for a meeting with the planning department, who's going to be implementing and mandating this in documents, and make sure that this is something that, you know, at least in an outline form that, you know, they can support.
Okay.
And, you know, we can show that document as, you know, this is what we would, you know, at the end, if we had the resources in the world, we'd create one for just Northampton. Mm-hmm. But here's our best case scenario and this, mm-hmm. and can this be implemented by the planning department and DPW? Because, you know, if we have no power to decree anything. So,
oh, sure, of course.
Know, those zoning and subdivision rules and regs are going to have to be changed by the planning board and the city council.
Right. Okay. Yeah, and that is not, that part of the whole project is not necessarily on your plate. Just want to make clear. Are you going to the planning department and kind of walk? If you want to take that part on, delightful. Mm-hmm. But
I just didn't want to, like, you know,
I actually had the exact same thought as Todd, which is just take a black marker and black part.
That's the simplest thing.
I mean, keep it super
right. Right. Jen, could you just note, though, that I don't think they include the southern trees. Like, I don't think they have sweet gum, I don't think they have tulip.
Okay, I can look.
Because I'm looking at the list right here.
Okay. And,
we had more on our list than they have.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. Right. Our list is more here, maybe.
Well, maybe we could just say, if it's not on the list, go look here.
At least have an addendum to that. If you're handing out a physical copy, an addendum with all the additional trees that you recommend is sorted at least by small, medium, and large.
Oh, sure. Yeah, that was going to be the format of the original document. Was originally I had it by species, like maples.
This. How does this sort by?
Alphabetical by scientific name, which is often not very helpful for people who, it's fine for me, but you know, it's not very helpful for.
But you can scan down a certain column. If you're just looking for trees of a certain size, you scan down, look for all the ones that are.
Yeah, it's got a very user-friendly way
visual.
Of finding large trees.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right.
Okay. So that's one thing. Then the then another thing was that I want to know I think it would be good if we had a planting diagram, like an acceptable planting diagram. So this is one I found, I'm not in love with it, but.
I thought I brought it today, but.
So we'll, it's a better one than this.
UMass Extension came out with a revised plan. The only thing they don't have is removing all of the wire in the burlap. They're just saying, remove as much as you can.
Okay.
So that's the only thing I'd like to change.
I think that sounds great. You know, we also created last year a proper mulching flyer. You know, the no volcano mulching and how to properly mulch.
Do you have that somewhere?
Yeah, I mean, we printed it, it enriches a whole box of them.
Oh, okay, that we could attach to it.
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
Absolutely.
I
make a note for yourself and email Rich to get you.
Would it be possible to have those documents to give out at Arbor Day? Or if it's a list of tree species, maybe they pay $1 for it or something.
Well, and also the proper mulching one.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Sure. Have those handouts for Arbor Day. That's when people who are interested in trees would be.
Yeah.
For the whips, when we hand out the
right. Oh, and the only other question I have is from looking at our tree management plan. The tree species that I would put a warning on, or whatever you want to call it, currently overplanted in the city, please limit plantings, were the maples.
Yep.
That was it, right? Okay. Okay, so I may call Tree Northampton, because there's a person on Tree Northampton that is like uber good at graphics. So
great.
I might just get in touch with her and say, here's my stuff, can you help me with it?
Great.
So that's kind of where I'm at, or where we're at. Is there anything else? Those were the notes that I wanted to. Okay, and if anybody does have another spec that's particularly good for planting, you know, just a, you know, a plant, this is a diagram of plant, I could spend a lot of time going through to try to find one, you know, that's big enough.
It sounds like Jay may
have
a good one.
Yeah, so.
Yeah, but you know what? I think that those little details are really helpful. The not just a list, but. So, and it would be great if they could hand that out with every.
The whole, like a pack.
Yeah.
So, okay. So that's where we're at. And hopefully I can.
Thank you.
Get it done.
Excellent.
Or get it finished.
Okay. And as far as planting site priorities, I'm getting some ideas actually in reading the various planning documents. Of what are already community affirmed priorities. I'm, as you know, meeting with Molly Freilisher to use iTree to help look at the canopy and see where some zones might be for planting. In addition, you and I need to get together because this is a topic that you and I were going to chew on and present a proposal back to you all for consideration. Having said that, since we have a little bit of extra time, I'm just wondering if we want to, I mean, we've done this brainstorm a little bit in the past, but it bears, I think it's an important one. And, you know, so I thought that with a little bit of time at today's meeting, we can see if there's anything we have not mentioned.
The details in that bike ped plan that was done recently should have hopefully quite a bit of detail on neighborhood specific, street specific tree planting priorities.
Yeah. In the bike ped plan?
Yep.
Probably
in the mapping side of it.
I think the only I saw one map and the only street it mentioned was Conn Street.
Let me ask Wayne about, because there were neighborhood based detail maps that should be part of that document.
Okay. I'm
pretty sure it's on the.
Okay, maybe that's.
It's hard to find on the website.
Can I officially put you on that?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So I'm just going to review some of the things we've talked about in the past and see if this jogs a little memory. Okay. Gateways into the city, school grounds, public right-of-ways. So we know from the tree inventory that we are at 81% of possible plantings in right-of-ways, and they recommend that we get to 90%.
What do you mean by, give me like a...
Tree belts.
Okay.
Yeah. Some of these are a little bit outside of our domain, but still, we can affirm them as priorities. Parking lots.
I'm just going to say a lot of the
shopping
malls, the trees are looking pretty bad.
They look horrible.
Yeah.
Need to be replaced.
Yeah.
A lot of that's for partially from mulching, too.
Yeah. Mm. But they are responsible for that.
No teeth, right? There's no... Yeah. No.
There's got to be somebody... Get on this.
Mm. All right. Low-income housing complexes, Hampshire Heights, Meadow... Meadowbrook?
In the adjacent tree belt?
I don't know. I think you'd have to go to each one and really look at where, and not necessarily in the adjacent tree belt. I mean, like within the complexes.
That's Housing Authority? Or it's variable over, it's variable?
It's variable. Uh-huh. Downtown Business District. Hospitals. So think Cooley Dick, VA. Waterways, this, I don't remember, we'll put this one on the list. Example, Mill River. Some of this is really outside of our bit.
Huh.
And then urban residential zoned areas, just like denser housing districts. You know, maybe walking routes to schools, not just school grounds, but walking routes to schools.
What about like bus stops?
Okay.
The trees in the parking lots are a whole separate, that's parking department?
It depends what parking lot. City parking lots are, yeah.
Central services?
Palmerans.
They're not like Rich's.
It's not uniform, yeah.
They weren't included in the inventory?
They're not public shade trees.
They're not public shade trees.
Oh, they're not? Even though they're owned by, they're on city land?
Weird.
Oh.
In other words, it's not something that we can just go do, like Rich can organize and just do right. Yeah.
So wait, whose domain did you say it was under?
The parking authority.
Well, it'd be David
Pomerantz. It's under David Pomerantz, who is the head of central services.
So are they?
Well, he's not a hostile.
No.
Yeah. He's been at one of these meetings we've talked to him about.
Yeah.
It's a coordination thing.
So, but they are theoretically, charged with taking care of the trees?
No.
Oh.
Not charged with taking care of the trees, no.
Oh.
Right?
Well,
I mean, definitely not. I mean, if they are, it's totally not.
Is there anybody who officially has responsibility for the trees?
You know, I don't think so, and I think it's part of why, and I don't know if you noticed, that Maplewood Shopping Center, it's got the, what are they?
London Plain.
Sycamores, London Plains. They're all being girdled at their base because there were pavers that were placed around them, and then they grew too wide for them, and they just started to girdle.
Okay, but those are on that city property.
That is central services.
So it just seems like there's some kind of something missing here.
Yes.
Right.
I think Rich spoke about this.
He has, but I'm forgetting what.
I think basically he said that. You know, when central services took over the parking lot, no one considered that they were also taking over the trees.
Oh.
It's probably not.
Well, so it's a design issue.
Yeah. And
they were dead the day they were planted.
Right. That too.
Yeah, but they provided a lot of great shade for a while. You know. And then
yeah,
there's no plan
out.
To replace them. There's no plan to replace them.
Wow.
So we do. I mean, I feel like at least those parking areas that are within city control, like, you know, behind Thor's Market and the Maple, you know, where the downtown and that have real impact. I feel like it's got to be somewhere on our priority list. You know, it doesn't necessarily have to be at the top, but it's.
Speaking of parking lots, I noticed that, I think at that new playing field on across from the Forest Gardens, didn't they put in the permeable kind of paving that water can soak through?
Yeah.
Is there any chance that could be put into some of these other parking lots that
you know, it's a question of resources.
Yeah, sure, but $5 million.
Yeah, right.
I mean, it would be great, but, yeah.
Well, when they change it, that's...
When, yeah, when it comes time for it to be repaid.
It's always the issue, never seem to get in the planning soon enough to...
Right. I wonder if that could be put in a wish list somewhere down the line, so that when it is repaved, we would, it would be desirable, at least theoretically, to have at least some areas where the trees are, to have that available.
Parking lot, even that playground, just for me?
Yeah, certain
Parts of it, not the whole thing. There actually is quite a bit of asphalt, but some of the overflow, it's actually the overflow parking, is that kind of, you know, mesh. Have you seen that stuff?
I'm just gonna go look.
Yeah, it's...
I've seen different things.
I mean, there's other ways of doing, I mean, that's one option. There's other ways of increasing rooting volume without having permeable pavement.
Yeah.
You can have a, like, regular size space, but there's other...
Structural soil.
Yeah, structural soil, there's other...
So, I mean, specifically downtown, two thoughts. Number one, we should probably invite Amy Callahan, who's the executive director of the Downtown Northampton Association, to one of our meetings. Although I sit on that board, you know, I think having us all interact with her could be a positive thing. And I say that because last summer, the DNA took the initiative, to make a list of like kind of basic infrastructure fixes in downtown that the city should prioritize and look at. And I think, you know, she's now kind of the caretaker of that with the mayor, David, and DPW director. So I think that, you know, adding our thoughts on, you know, the public shade tree experience downtown, you know, could be valuable to get on that prioritization list.
Okay, great. And her name is Amy Callahan. Will you just connect me with her email or something?
Sure.
Okay. Yeah. In some of these plans and reports that I've been reviewing, you know, they strongly encourage, again, this is like a major infrastructure redo, but that we create brand new public spaces for trees, such as an island going down South Street, or, you know, an island bifurcating Main Street.
Right.
So I think we should keep pushing for that.
And for the center of all the roundabouts we're putting in, which are barren of anything.
Yeah, that's what that is. Is there like DOT standards about vision?
Probably. I say with disdain.
I know.
Take into consideration trees, though.
No, but if you have big enough trees in the center island, they're not going to be a visual block.
Yeah, right. See right through them. All right, well, I'll add roundabouts to the list with a question mark.
You also don't usually have to see through a roundabout anyway. When you're in the roundabout, you just need to see the lane in front of you. You don't look across it to the other side.
Well, one down at Con Street is better because it's kind of small. You need to anticipate cars
that are coming in that you might, you know, run into.
But you could put, you know, a very, you know, relatively large tree in there. Mm-hmm.
You
know?
Could.
Totally.
That'd be great.
Yeah.
All right, any other suggested planting site priorities?
No, other than to prioritize and get rid of the ones we have no authority over.
Okay, yeah.
That's right. I mean, there are all these ones we don't have authority over that we can get to late, you know, eventually.
Yeah, or but Tree Northampton can go after it, or River Group, or whatever, but I mean, I don't want us to focus on the bike ways and the Mill River one.
Yes. I probably would have mentioned those from my personal list, but I would pause at something like hospitals, and for me, it's also like a public relations thing, because I feel like if we planted, I know that Cooley Dickinson, for example, used to have that whole line of like, are they just white pines?
Spruce too.
Right on Route 9.
And most of them are gone now, right? Mm-hmm. Or all of them? You have stories behind that, but
we planted them when I worked. Cotton tree, we moved them from one part of the grounds to another.
Yeah.
And we offered them a care plan to take care of the trees. And they didn't want, they said, we can do it ourselves, we have our own groups. And they never watered them. They spent thousands and thousands of dollars moving 30-foot trees and just didn't water.
Oh, wow.
And they were out in the tree belt, or where were they?
There's no belt, they were right against the...
They were expanding their parking lot, you know, where the parking lots were, so they moved them.
But although that would be technically on their property, I just feel like that there could be some really nice public-private collaboration. There would be public benefit because it's, you know, in, more or less in the right of way, would have public viewing. And there's a story there. I mean, we could definitely spin a story about the value of trees for you know, human healing. So, you know, when we can cherry pick some of these things that are a little bit off our, you know, highest priority list because they have the ability to garner support.
We're certainly saying, you know, we're willing and able and want to plant, you know, 10 public shade trees along the right of way and hope that you, you know, match our planting and, you know, internally.
Yeah.
And it's new, it's Mass General now, not who was it before, so there may be more interest.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Any other thoughts about that? Okay.
And did you also talk about priority streets besides Conn Street or whatever?
Well, I mean, I'm happy to go back and or Todd's going to go and look and review the plans.
Oh, you're going to look at them.
But Molly and I are going to do that bird's eye view, where we're going to actually look for breaks in the canopy.
Oh, good.
And that will help inform us.
Okay.
Although it might inform us that there's nowhere to plant on those streets, like right. Rob already kind of has a, you know.
Right.
I think we're also waiting for more information for this to come out too.
Yeah.
Before.
I want to just throw out another way of going about this, and you can shoot it down. I'm not attached to it, but one of the things we could do is we could sort in the tree keeper for all those planting sites that can accommodate the biggest trees and prioritize those. And one of the reasons being is they will eventually give us the most bang for the buck.
Yeah. Get them started as soon as possible.
As soon as possible.
Yeah,
because they're
going to take a long time.
Hmm.
That's a good idea.
May have to
Okay.
Yeah. Might have to confer with Rich as far.
Oh, well, it doesn't matter because he's not quite, well.
It's not here. It's hard to.
Well, to court the logistics stuff.
Right. It's just hard to tell which are the big sites because they didn't list them. And there are a lot of sites for large trees that they didn't list as sites for large trees. A lot.
Oh.
Well, we can start with the ones that they did.
List.
Right.
Why?
But they have requirements of 40 feet from any wire, 40 feet horizontal.
Uh-huh.
So in Northampton, that's not the way it's been done.
Yeah, have you done a search? Have you figured out how many sites that they said could accommodate the trees?
I thought there were about 300 or 400.
Oh, well, that's
large
not
tree.
Bad.
Yeah.
What?
That's you. Do you want to do that for us and report back?
But you know that includes on the other side of the side places where there's no sidewalk too, which you know those we probably want to put aside. It's a lot.
Oh, you mean on some of those developments off Ryan Road where they just have no sidewalks?
In other words, it includes those spaces, so that's not very useful. I mean, really, but here's the problem.
Why would you deem that not useful?
Well, the problem is that the tree belts, which is probably the most interesting place to put trees, they required more than 6 feet before they put a big tree. So they took away all the big trees from all the tree belts, which is probably exactly what we want.
Right, and we had this discussion, I don't know if you were here for it, at least maybe two meetings ago, Molly, where we decided that their standards for the required width of the tree belt was too stringent.
Oh yeah, remember that, yeah.
But you know, if there are side streets off of Ryan Road where there are no sidewalks, and therefore there's plenty of room for trees to, you know, to plant big trees because their roots will go, you know, utilities notwithstanding, then why wouldn't we be excited about those?
Because I think the denser areas where there's a good 4-foot, 5-foot tree belt, would be way priority over that, where people actually walk and there are sidewalks.
But see, the thing is, people walk there, they're just walking the street.
Oh, well, if it's a place where people, where there's any kind of density, I didn't, I'm not really aware of a place where there's density and no sidewalk.
Also.
A lot of the side streets.
Right. Well, also from a, I think it's worth it for us just to keep overall in mind that, like, economic considerations, you know? Like, if we're planting up in South Street, there is some rental places, but most of those houses are big.
Yeah.
You know, you gotta be at a certain income level to be able to
yeah.
buy a house. But, you know, Ryan Road area traditionally has been
right.
more, you know, ranch houses or more houses that are more people with afford with modest, mm-hmm. more modest income.
Yeah.
I mean, not all of them.
Right.
But, so I think it's worthwhile when we're thinking about it, just throw that in the pot too.
Yeah,
that
I totally
that
agree.
We're,
yeah.
So another priority, it would be another way to slice that is to just make sure that we're distributing the plantings more, you know, throughout the seven wards.
Mm-hmm. I think Rich has a good view of that. Mm-hmm. He's very familiar with every street and lives in most of the houses. Mm-hmm. And so when he looks at where the trees are going, he looks to see that they're extremely spread out. And that goes against part of what we want, which is the high visibility. Because
right. We do have conflicting.
There's a lot of conflicting things there.
Things sometimes, yeah.
We've been out planting quite a few trees in front yards, like out Ryan Road and out Florence Road and out, you know, out there. And that's been very good because there are big trees, there's a big space. That's great. But they're not very, you know, no one, well, few will see them. Not a high value.
Well, I don't think that we should, it's a balance, but I don't think that we should feel guilty about prioritizing high density areas because that is where most people walk. And, mm-hmm. And you know, they're more likely to walk if it's a comfortable experience.
And my observation is that there are a lot of high density areas, and that's partly why I think there's been a concentration on the North Street neighborhood, mm-hmm. that not everybody is so affluent.
Right, sure. Oh, yeah, totally.
So there's North Street, there are little streets off of King Street, there's over towards Stoddard, there's a whole area in there that is bereft of trees and yeah. also not particularly high income.
And I think we should have, whether it's for publicity or actual demonstration, I think we should have like kind of demonstration streets or blocks where we purposely plant it like we want it to look and don't mess around and the whole under all the wires put all the smaller trees mm-hmm. with, you know, flowering trees and on the other side just plant it aggressively yeah. as best practices call for and say that is what the city should look like.
That does remind me of something, and that is this whole, we've looked at the model of trying to plant species or alternating maybe just two species along a given street and then switching up another street. So for example, Cherry Street has, you know, combination of cherries and da-da-da. Instead of just going for this very shotgun kind of biodiversity, how do you guys feel about that as a concept?
I don't think there's anything wrong with doing that. I prefer it myself rather than
me too.
Too many species.
Okay. Others?
I guess my personal preference, you know, if it was my street, I would want to have a variety of trees on it, just because it's more interesting. Mm-hmm.
Depends on the street. And, you know, depends on a lot of things, but there's no problem with putting like two species on a short street, and that's it.
So there's a, people generally I think design like to have a pattern, but a pattern can actually mean something more like what Jay is saying, where there's a great variety, because it's about sort of expecting what you're gonna have. So, but in other words, if you're in a place like Northampton where there are very many different sorts of trees all over the place, if you had trees all lined up perfectly, it would be switching pattern. So you just have to be aware that, because that's it's totally contrary to the current pattern. The current pattern is sets of trees, actually. So there are very many places that will be like five or six.
Actually, now that you mention it, I do like that. Yeah.
And then five or six of another. Yeah. That, because there were people went out and planted in certain generations and then got a place. So there are groupings like on Route 9 on Elm Street. There are now a whole bunch of London pine trees. And then there's a little patch of hickories.
Yeah.
And then.
All right, I'm changing my mind. I can picture some places in town that have that. There's those.
Bright Street is an example. Bright Street used to have, you know, honey locusts really beautifully creating this.
Well, when you have the arc or elms, you know, that used to do that. That's amazing.
Bright Street's, I think, one of the only streets left in the whole Northampton where there's actually all the way across and a single species up and down the street.
Wow.
That I can think of.
There are a couple others, but yeah.
From a design perspective, sometimes, especially with the small trees, like underwires, it definitely, when they're uniform, you can get like a traffic calming.
Yeah. You really can.
You do. It's well documented.
It is.
All right. I'm totally on board now. I'm excited about this other idea.
So, is there anyone that disagrees with that concept? Because if not, I feel like that we should definitely affirm that in our priorities.
What was the concept? Roofs?
The concept is creating patterns, you know, in streets.
Patterns of roofs.
Not doing a whole mishmash of diverse trees.
Like a row of cherries.
See, sometimes, a visual pattern. Just in a practical sense, because I've been doing this, so like for 4 years, so Jay was just on Washington Ave, where I live. There's not really an opportunity to put rows, but there's like one here, one there, you know. And so there are a whole bunch of, now there's like a whole pattern, it's not in a straight row, of ginkgos. There are now seven ginkgo trees on my block.
Yeah.
And there'll probably be a few more, but they're actually even. But they're not in a row. But it means when you drive down the street, it'll be like, oh, there are, at the right time of year especially, it will be like this blast.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
So,
good. All right. I think we can wrap up this portion of the discussion. All right, and Todd, let's you and I try to schedule some meetings and put those together. All right, Arbor Day planning. Wow, we actually got behind now on our
schedule. Oh, my
gosh. I know.
Marilyn's not here to do her recap.
Well, this is tricky. I think we should say Arbor Day, and it's really just a celebration of Arbor Day that will not take place on Arbor Day. I mean, I think we can affirm that because that's a climate march, or as close to it as you can get. And most of us, or many of us, will be away. So I'm just, you know, that's just like a bookmark. But it's some kind of, you know, I think we, you know, talk now about whip distribution, some kind of planting, and Molly and I reached out to kids at Northampton High School in their game. And now that ball is in Rich's court to connect to grounds at NHS and the principal at NHS, to identify sites. I think we need a backup plan, frankly, because Rich is maxed out.
Yeah.
And this is not rising to the top of his priority list. And what I remember last time is that if we try to do this at the last minute with the school, you get a defensive grounds staff, and you don't have enough time to address their defensiveness. Mm-hmm. And so then you end up throwing the trees in places that you don't necessarily want to throw them. So I think maybe we should consider another, we could have upwards of 10 volunteers from this high school.
Or is there another way that we can move the process faster? I mean, could you or me talk to the school?
I could reach out to the principal because I did to all the elementary schools last year, and that's the easy part. The harder part is the ground.
Right. So what would be involved? Wouldn't we want to actually talk with the grounds crew directly?
I think I actually think it's more of a Rich thing. That's an area where I
because
won't.
He's
you know
with the DPW and sort of speaks the same language and all that. Yeah,
that was my experience last year. Yeah.
more work to mow around a tree than go in a straight line.
Sure, right.
We're a little concerned about the tree.
So you wanted a site on the high school grounds?
I wanted to explore it, yeah. And maybe do a cluster planting or something like that, or, I don't know.
But I also like the idea of, you know, that the high school kids could help plant trees in the tree belts too, along the streets.
Yeah, I mean, we don't have to stay wed to the high school.
We should go to the hospital.
I did think about that.
Oh.
Yeah.
That would be a good backup plan.
Except for things may move even slower within the hospital than in a school.
What about Smith Vocational students? I wonder if any of them would, they have a forestry program, which isn't the same as tree planting. Do they have any horticulture there?
We look at each other and roll our eyes.
We have a long history with them. I actually sit on the forestry horticulture advisory board.
Oh, really?
So, oh, yeah.
Oh, I know that.
Yeah.
So you're saying you don't think it would work?
You know, we have 10 games.
I've reached out to them many times and never even got a response.
It's frustrating.
Oh. We have 10 game NHS students. Yeah. I feel like that is the makings of them.
Yeah. I mean, I'll keep working on Smith Book. I don't really understand what's going on.
Hmm. Yeah, strange.
Yeah.
All right. What about you, Rob? Do you have any thoughts about
The 501(c)?
Oh, no, wait, sorry, we're not ready to go into that. Right. I was asking you if you had any thoughts about what the high school students we could plant.
What's the date? Does it matter? Do we have it?
No, it can be flexible.
Flexible.
Oh, in fact, no, actually, that's not true. Molly, you and I sat down and came up with some dates that the students could do.
I know, I didn't write them down.
I did because I sent it to Rich.
Okay.
Rich and H.
This is where students could help plant trees?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. They're from the environmental
club. In April, beginning of May?
So this is
what I'm just going to read the email I sent to Rich. Hi, Rich. Today, Molly Hale and I met with the head of NHS's environmental club, Gretchen Savison, to discuss tree planting at NHS or elsewhere. Gretchen feels confident that 10 environmental club kids could come out for Arbor Day tree planting this spring. As last year, should you and I do a drive around NHS to look for planting sites, and afterward you reach out to the principal and head of grounds to confirm our site suggestion. And then I said, with Arbor Day, the day before the National Climate March, we thought we'd do planting on a different weekend. We thought a 12 noon to 4 p.m. window would be good, so as not to interfere with sports games or church. Here are the weekend days when Molly, Gretchen, and I are available. So we came up with Sunday, April 9th, or Saturday, April 15th, Sunday, April 16th, or Saturday, April 22nd.
Say those dates again, 9, 15?
9, 15, 16, 22.
22nd is right there.
Yeah, but that's great, right?
When's the march?
The march is the 29th. That day is actually the science march, but. Gotta make your choices.
Well,
a lot of
you know, I'm sure there are sites within a quick walk of the high school that come under Rich's, you know, the public spots. You don't need to confer with
that.
Yeah. And I would work with Rich to come up with those spots.
You know. Okay. All right. So, should we first still try to salvage the idea of doing a planting on the high school grounds? Do you know the grounds well, Jen?
Of the high school?
Yeah.
There's a lot of trees up there.
There's a big delivery of trees sometimes. And again, it's Rich. I mean, he will order the trees to come from Amherst Nursery. And I don't know that usually April 1st is when stuff like that starts. So April 9th, you know, who will know if the trees have come or arrived?
My concern was going into May. I just felt like May is just a risk your time for planting.
Well, so I'm just saying later in April 15th or 22nd.
15th, 16th, or 22nd?
Yeah, okay. It's probably more likely that, more certain, it's pretty certain the trees will arrive.
It's helpful to know.
And so that would be good. I mean, you know, it's up to Rich to, this year, who knows, the ground's already thawed.
So I know, so I don't know. Everything earlier.
What do you think, Jay? Would they be digging early?
I don't think it's thawed yet.
Huh?
I don't think it's thawed yet.
Well, I can dig a shovel deep depth in my yard. I did. I mean, I went out and I started digging already.
What?
I don't know generally whether that's true. But I'm just saying, the nurseries, do they like, do you think they're gonna like?
Depends on how wet.
When do you think the nurseries?
Depends on how wet.
It's wet, yes. They have wetness problems too, so.
Yeah, you don't want to mess around in there if it's wet.
Yeah, so we don't know about the trees.
Okay. But you're saying that it's, 15th through the 22nd is better than the 9th?
Yeah.
The 9th just feels.
They might not be willing to go with it.
All right, that's helpful enough.
I guess.
And just.
All right.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I know that the Arts Night Out was looking for kind of a theme for April. I think that's the 21st. So they were thinking about flowers or something, but I just said I'd bring it to our attention today that if we want to do something downtown around Arts Night Out in April, that, you know, we could push that idea.
Well, okay, so don't we still have that sculpture in a spot?
Yeah, I think the DPW has it somewhere.
Oh, okay, but there was a spot on the far side of Main Street, right?
It got planted.
Yeah, two of them got planted.
Oh, they did get planted?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, great.
But it could go, there's more trees, so.
Are there more spots ready to go? Where a tree has a, you know, fighting chance of survival?
Yep, it's all supposed to happen.
So, I mean, that's a high visibility thing for the high school kids to plant on Main Street.
Yeah, I don't know if it's practical or would work, or if we just want to do the golden tree again, or do a couple of them, or nothing, but.
I like the golden tree.
Do you want me to go up to the high school and cruise around and look?
Yeah, why don't you do that?
I can do that.
That'd be great.
Yeah, I can do that.
Okay.
It's small.
And then, you know, it's predicated on them being willing to do that.
It's shiny.
And does anyone want to do the same thing with the hospital? Does anyone have time to, if you're up there, could you just take a look at the hospital right next, you know, right on whatever. Yeah.
So at the hospital, there's a very wide.
Yeah, yeah.
And.
The bus stop right there?
Wait, is there an actual tree belt?
Huge.
Oh, and it's not occupied?
No, and the wire, but the wire is not a problem. So there, you know, it would be I would like to see Dawn Redwoods or some giants planted there. I don't know what.
That'd be nice.
You know, I mean, there's room for big.
Do you get Dawn Redwoods?
The tree belt's like 10 feet wide there, and so.
Do you get Dawn Redwoods around here?
Yeah. Yeah, so I'm just saying that it'd be nice to put some really big trees there, and the big trees that we would want to put there probably won't be delivered first this spring.
Oh, they won't?
Probably in the fall.
Okay.
That's good to know.
Yeah.
Okay, so we have to take that off the list then?
There may be a few big trees here and there, but the trees that belong there, which are special, it's a special spot, those are not gonna be here in the spring.
I wonder if Cooley Dick would like to have, like right at the entrance where the ambulances go in, you know, two trees on either side of that, that would be like a entryway.
Yeah, I mean.
Kind of, it would make a really nice.
I can drive up entrance.
I think there's trees there.
A lot of trees.
No, okay.
On the tree belt?
If you're facing the hospital, I'm talking about to the left where the parking lot is.
Oh, yeah.
On the tree, there's a huge tree belt.
Right on Route 9.
Right on Route 9.
But we're not gonna plant there because we're not gonna have the trees, so that's a moot point.
You want to reserve those for your biggest.
Right.
Some.
I'll drive up there and look.
All right, so look for any other spots.
I mean, maybe it's not so big that it can be a, but it's huge.
I mean, that would be a home run if we had high school students planting trees in front of a hospital. I mean, we could really build a lot of great PR around it.
I get what you're saying, yep.
So if, you know, if possible, or we do it in the fall. But I also think high school students helping out in downtown is not a bad thing either, too, so.
There's also that women's health center that used to be associated with the birthing center.
Oh, yeah.
That's right. That may be, let me, I'll drive up there and address.
So that's on the to-do list. No one has been creating a to-do list, so log it. All right, that's all I'm gonna say about Arbor Day, because Tree Northampton is handling the whips. The whips, everybody got a list of potential, the list of available whips. And if you had feelings about them.
I think Marilyn was gonna do something about assigning the whips to.
Was she?
I'm not sure. We all, I just said we would help, and I'm not sure what you did.
Do we check in with her about that?
Yeah.
Yeah, because I don't think that's my understanding of it, or, yeah. All righty? Okay. All right, quick report on the pruning training, and then tree work camping.
We're really brief. We had a training, Jay led it, and I thought it was good, there were a dozen people that were, hoping that Rich will, through Tree Northampton, help organize some very small, cautious first ventures of having volunteers do some pruning, maybe next week. And so that's good. I think I was, got to get to the little trees and prune them. You had asked about the 501(c), and the Tree Northampton has applied to the state of Massachusetts to be a nonprofit corporation. And that's in the hand of, that's been sent in a while ago, and we're just waiting for Massachusetts to return that. And then that creates a nonprofit. It just doesn't have federal tax status. So it's kind of.
It can start collecting donations.
That's right.
Potentially retroactively giving people tax deductions when they get their status.
Right. And so the, you know, there's nothing we can do to speed it up because it'll come back from Massachusetts. You have to be registered in the state before you can go to the federal.
So you're gonna have to be, have a board of directors and have
yeah.
bylaws.
Oh yeah, yeah, we've got a lot. We, you know, we had to have that in order to register in the state of Massachusetts.
Mm-hmm. What's the size of the board?
I think it's five. Mm-hmm. Five board members. You know, we have a treasurer, a president and a clerk. Those are the things you have to have. I think, probably, I guess it's not on our, it might be on our website, I'm not sure. Somewhere, yeah. Some of that detail.
Okay.
So optimistic, anyway.
All right, good, thanks. To-do list. It's in the vault. Does everyone know, Molly, you know that we have an up-to-date to-do list that is a group.
Do you send that out?
Yeah.
Do you send that out every month before the meeting?
We don't send it out. It's a Google Drive.
Oh, it's another
document.
Google.
So it's just something that Marilyn is constantly adding to.
Oh.
And I find it very helpful, personally.
Yeah.
I check before, you know, like a week before a meeting to see what's on my to-do list, and I'm jogged about what I need to do. So
I checked in. Everything said done. Is that true?
With
nice.
You,
yes.
Everything
yes.
on the list start my list.
Well, did you look on your page? There's a separate page
There's
for each person.
There's tabs for each person.
Okay.
You were probably looking at Rich's, when you first opened it up, it goes to Rich's page.
Yeah, it's done.
You look at the bottom, it has a tab with your name on it.
Now right. You're going to be on
that. I'm going to be on that, yeah.
Yeah.
I'll do it later.
Well, and if there, you know, Marilyn is not here, and I don't know if she did it for last week. It doesn't look like she did the last time we met. So if, you know, if you take a moment to put things on your list so you don't forget, because that's, it's very helpful, I find.
I will not be here next, on the 15th.
Okay. All right. That sounds really familiar. I wonder if I'll be.
By March. Not by April. That's really March.
Oh, actually, you know what? Thank you for mentioning that, Molly, because I'm actually realizing that I'm faced with a conflict, actually, on Wednesdays this semester, because my son is doing a Shakespeare program, and I am tied into the carpool on Wednesday nights. And I'm sorry to just put this on you guys at the last moment here in the meeting, but it's problematic.
Every Wednesday? What's your concern?
Yeah, I mean, I might be able to get my husband to do some of them, but he spends a lot of time in the day driving.
Could we consider shifting to once a month?
That would help, but it's a significant shift going to once a month. I wouldn't want to do it without Rich's input.
Are you saying you wouldn't be able to make, what are you saying exactly that you wouldn't be able to do?
I'm saying that I could be regularly missing entire meetings because I have to be up in Turner's Falls. I have to leave here to be up in Turner's Falls by 5 o'clock, and I'm gonna stay up there until my son's rehearsal is done and come back at 5.
You have to leave here at 5?
I have to leave here at 4.
Oh.
But if
wow.
maybe once a month, it'd be easier to get covered.
Yeah, that is true. That is
not
true.
Not to get into your own. It's up to you.
Yeah.
It would make
yeah.
it easier. Half as hard.
I guess I'll just throw it out there. Is there any other day that works for people? I think we've been through this before, and I'm not sure that we ever did come up with a day.
Yeah, it's kind of tough for me because I organize my other stuff
up around it. Yeah,
making sure that I can do this Wednesday.
All right.
I'm flexible.
Why don't you change the time?
I'm flexible.
Excuse me?
Do it later?
Until like 3?
Or?
Are you pretty boxed in for this time? Yeah.
What about later
well,
on?
Well, I can do any day.
It would be crazy late. It would be. We'd all be comatose.
Oh.
Terry, doesn't Rich have another meeting?
I do.
You do.
It's not on the third Tuesday of the month.
All right. Listen, I'm gonna just.
Could do a doodle poll or something.
How do people feel about experimenting with, first of all, this is all predicated on Rich, but how do you feel about experimenting with switching to once a month?
We can try it.
You like it?
Pro that.
We can try it.
It's all right.
We could use the off week to, you know, to whatever we're working on,
yeah.
you know, committee-wise or treatment camp, you know what I mean?
Yeah. I mean, personally speaking, I'm a little nervous about it because I really see momentum just kind of, unless people really are engaged in subcommittee or whatever,
mm-hmm,
partner
mm-hmm.
work. But we could try it. And
how
if so, I feel very confident that once a month I can figure out.
Mm-hmm. How long's the commitment?
It's all spring. It's like through the end of May.
How many?
But that's really not that long.
Well, that's true. Yeah, so it's like 3 months of once a month meetings.
Can we have 3 people meet without being a violation? Is that right? Or, I mean, I'm talking about these working, because I think if we had some working groups, that would
for
be
open meeting law.
I think if 3 of us, or 2 or 3, if we got together, that mm-hmm. could be productive. Mm-hmm. Maybe some of the work.
Mm-hmm.
I think it would be great if people would do that.
We'd have any more on it.
Yeah, we would. But we could, in fact, I feel confident that we could work that into it. Okay, well, so with your blessing, I am going to approach Rich about this conflict short-term. Thank you for making me feel like it's not forever. It's really
right.
just
so
March,
you,
April, May. It's
yeah.
3 months.
Yeah.
So which week of the month would we have to shift into?
Well, why don't you talk to Rich first of all
yeah.
before we even go there?
So let me just say that Rich goes for it. If he goes for it, should we plan our next meeting in 1 month?
Mm-hmm.
Or 4 weeks from now, more.
Can you keep it the first
Wednesday?
Because I have the room booked.
Yeah,
that's easy.
So it would be
me, though, too.
That would be the first
thing.
First
yeah.
Wednesday of month. Okay.
Right.
Okay. So I'm going to ask Rich if for the next 3 months we can switch to once a month on the first Wednesday of the month, same time. Okay. All right. Thank you for your flexibility, folks. Sorry about that. Motion to adjourn this meeting.
So beautiful.
Go ahead.
He's on it. Oh, you
yeah.
go.
All right.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay.